$5 to send to Doris. So I will get a box and put out in the vestibule. If any of you have some in your closet, I'll pick some up. I'll buy some. We would appreciate it. And I don't know how expensive it is to ship things, but we're going to try to ship it to Doris. So we're going to ask all of you for your participation. It don't have to be a doll with clothes. She can be a doll that doesn't have clothes. We will try to get somebody that sewed to dress the dolls. If not, we'll cut up some material and pin it on them, and we'll ship it to them. So at this point, I'd just like to ask all of you to be in prayer for all of the missionaries.
For our scripture memorization, we'll recite the verse, we'll address the verse, Acts 17:31b and 1 John 1:7, can be found inside the first page of the bulletin. All together, Acts 17:31b. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. Acts 17:31b. 1 John 1:7. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. 1 John 1:7. Thank you.
Thank you, Omari. Thank you, Ruth, for that report on missions. A church without a missions program really is not a church. It's just a social group. But the Great Commission was given to us by our risen Lord, am I right? And that has not been rescinded. God never said, I withdraw my need to reach the people in South Africa. Amen? I didn't read that verse. No. Go into all the world and do what? Preach the gospel to how many? All men, to every creature, to every ethnic group in your nation, in your country, in your world. Now, obviously, we got ethnic groups all around us now, right? Right here in America, we can go next door. But that does not take back the need for us to go and present the gospel of Jesus Christ to those who know not the Savior. As a matter of fact, after I finish the book of Revelation, now I asked you to read the book of Revelation, right? So I'm not going to stop it in the midst of the program. Why? Because it's God's word. God promises blessings to you if you simply open the Bible and read from the book. Is that difficult? Now there are symbols in there, there are prophetic terms that are there, and you may need somebody to help you with that. But let's read. But once I finish the book of Revelation, I'm going to preach on missions and the local church, the Bible basis for missions. Why do we pray for the Rinderknecks? Why do we send little baby dolls to Doris Gouger in Kenya? Why do we send money to Jackie Huggins in the Philippines? Why? Obviously, we don't have an awful lot of money to send. Am I right? And I'm not saying we should not reevaluate perhaps how we're sending our money. That's appropriate for the local church to do. But
since God has called us to share the gospel with those who are lost. And I think we need to continue to try to do that. Doesn't forbid us to go to our neighbors and our community and tell our friends about the Lord Jesus Christ, because that's called the good news. So I'm up here to ask you to, number one, praise God for giving us the strength and the wisdom to preach the word. Praise Him for it. Thank God for it. He woke me up this morning. He started me on my way. Am I right? So let's give Him the praise and the glory for what He has been doing for us. If we have employment, then God says, give me at least one dime for every dollar you make. Right? If you didn't make a dollar, we really can't accuse you of being dishonest if you didn't make anything. But if God sent into your account funds, then He says, honor me with your substance and with the first fruit of all of your increase. I want to thank God for these ushers. Thank you for your servant attitude, really. Yeah, and praise God for you. And for those of us who are able to give, we will ask that you would stand with us. We'll pray together. We're going to ask the officers to come, amen, to receive from you what God has blessed you to receive. Father, we give you praise this morning for life, health, and strength. We ask now for your blessings upon these, our gifts, as we bring them to you. May your name always be honored and glorified. And whatever is accomplished, Father, we'll give you the praise and thanksgiving. Well, we pray and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Come around this morning as we pray. Side.
Ernestine Thomas and Joseph Thomas. Grew up Southern Heights Baptist Church all my life. This is my beginning, and a very strong beginning. Eternally grateful for my roots and where I came from. So I've been blessed to know the difference between good word and people who are just using words.
Amen.
I've been a member of New Covenant Baptist Church in Orlando, Florida for the past 6 or so years. I've been in Orlando for quite some time, so it's been a little over that, maybe 10 years. So a pastor now is Reverend Leroy Rose III. Currently, I am a member of the praise and worship team. The choir took a lot of our time, and they kind of made us be a praise and worship leader now. So I'm in the background, which is okay, which brings me to my point. I just want to share a little bit my lesson that I was dealing with and was given was the lesson of humility. Learning to be humble, even though you have gifts, it doesn't mean that you always have to be in the front. And it was a hard pill to swallow for me. and I'm okay with that. But someone reminded me, and I did have counsel with my pastor as well, which I'm very happy of, that that I can talk to my pastor. I can reach out and call him, and I can, you know, actually see him, and he'll make time to talk and discuss things that are important to me, important to, and it's also important to the church. At any rate, we talked about, you know, being humble and making sure that your center is correct.
Yes.
And Jesus should always be the center of everything that you do, everything that you are, everywhere that you go. And so that's what I want to share today. This song is a praise and worship song that we sing called Jesus Be the Center. It's very simple. So after I sing it a couple of times, hopefully maybe you might help me out a little bit. A very simple song, guys, very repetitive. And it's sound, it just goes like this. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it has always been, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it has always been, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Nothing even matters, nothing in this world but you. Jesus, you're the center, everything revolves around you. Jesus, you, Jesus, be the center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it has always been, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, 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 from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about you, yes, it's all about you, from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about you. Yes, it's all about you, from my heart to the heavens. Jesus, be the center, it's all about you. Yes, it's all about you, from my heart to the heavens. Jesus, be the center, it's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. Jesus, be the center of this church. Jesus, be the center of this church. From beginning to the end, it has always been, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, 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 nothing even matters, nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center, everything revolves around you, Jesus, you.
Jesus be the center of it all.
Oh, yes.
Jesus be the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it has always been, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Nothing even matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus be the center. Everything revolves around you. Jesus, you.
Thank you so much, Tiffany. Setting the focus for our worship of the Lord today. Jesus is all about you. Be the center of everything that I do. You're not the little girl that used to go to FBFA conferences and participate in the competition with special gifts for FBFA. But you are a woman of dignity. We thank God for you. You're a professional young lady, and I hope and pray that God will always be the very center. Am I right? Of everything that we do, the very center of everything that we do. I appreciate that. Appreciate your life, your testimony. Thank God for your parents. And we just wanna worship you here today. Reverend Howard led us in wonderful grace of Jesus. What a song. How can we sing that and not be moved and stirred on the inside concerning this wonderful, awesome, magnificent grace of Jesus that reached down into the gutter and picked us up and put God's Spirit on the inside of us and sent us forth to represent the Lord Jesus Christ. It is so good to be here this morning. Thank you, Omari, for reading the scriptures for us today. And it goes right along with what I'm talking about here this morning. But you may take your bulletin home in case you didn't bring your Bible. It's always good to bring the Bible, amen? It's always good to turn to the book. Read from the Word of the living God. Allow God to speak to our hearts through His Word. I realize that we are in the midst of the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 11. And chapter 11 gives us information about what is going to come on tomorrow. Incidentally, for those of us who are born again and saved, we won't be up on earth when Revelation 11 takes place. But how good it is to read next to the last verse that was read in Revelation 11, where it says, I'm going to go back to 8:15. Then the seventh angel sounded, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of His Christ, and He shall reign forever and ever. And someone says here that this is just no ordinary voice. I mean, it's like the voice of a lion when he's ready to stalk his prey and to get himself a delicious meal. He roars, and the roar frightens the enemy, or at least the one the lion wants to have for dinner. So it is an ordinary, it's not an ordinary roar, not an ordinary sound. It sounds like many waters. It sounds like trouble is coming. It sounds like a Katrina is on its way, a Category 5 storm. And the Lord is about to make some announcements. You see, he says in verse 12, the voice says, come up here. And they ascend to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies saw them. In the same hour, there was a great earthquake, and a tenth of the city fell. In the earthquake, 7,000 people were killed, and the rest were afraid and gave glory to the God of heaven. We're not in the midst of the tribulation, but this describes it. And it's described in the book of Daniel, it's described in the book of Matthew, it is described here to key us to what is happening here. This is not going to happen while the church is here. Notice, if you will, in verse 2 of Revelation chapter 11. But leave out the court which is outside the temple, and do not measure it, for it has been given to the Gentiles, and they will tread the holy city underfoot for 42 months. How much time is 42 months? Well, when you add these up, you will discover that this is a 3.5-year period in which this kind of trouble is going to come up on this earth. And we believe and preach and teach that the church will be raptured, and the church will not be here. Therefore, those who refuse to believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, who turn another ear and refuse to accept the Lord Jesus as their own personal Savior, they will be left here when the church is snatched up. You know what I'm talking about? Yes. The church will be raptured. It will be taken up, snatched away. And believers who are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ will be taken up through the cloud to meet the Lord in the air. This period is described right here in this text by 1,200 days. Same thing, 3.5-year period. This is the same person who reigns and rules in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 3 and 4, where it talks about that man of sin who is going to come, and he is going to go into the temple and demand that the people in the temple worship him. And the Jewish people have learned by an example that you never worship an idol. You never worship a demon. Our Sunday school teacher was mentioning that here this morning, book of 1 Corinthians. You see, a demon is nothing, an idol is nothing. They have no power independent of this whole concept. If you think that a demon is bothering you, then perhaps he has captured your mind. And we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places, Ephesians chapter 6. Wherefore we are to do what? Take unto us how much of it? The whole armor of God, line upon line, verse by verse, one paragraph upon another paragraph. As believers in Christ, we are to be learning the word of the Lord Jesus Christ, because there's power in the word of God. And for those who do not expose themselves to the word of God, you are missing your defense mechanism. Everybody's kind of concerned about what happened with that Malaysian jet, you know, 17. Wow, the other one went down, they haven't found it. Amen? But when you have, when you're armed with a defense mechanism, you know, the certain blood cells fight off chemicals that would destroy you, because the body defends itself, basically. When you are wrapped up in the Word of God, and when you come apart to learn the scriptures, that is your spiritual defense against the demonic forces that will come at you as sure as I am here. Don't think you're going to walk through this life and not be tempted or tested or tried to fall away and to do something that is contrary to the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we're in a passage of scripture that takes you throughout the whole Bible. I shall never forget when I was at in seminary before I graduated from Grace. We had to translate the book of Zechariah. And some of the things that are mentioned here in Revelation 13 show up in the book of Zechariah. These two olive trees, and who are these two prophets that come up on the scene and they prophesy things and they have power from God and they speak, and when they speak, a fire comes out of their mouth and God gives them the power to be protected. So Revelation 11 is not one of those isolated passages where you just rip it out of the Bible and think that somehow this seems to be so horrible. Oh no! And who these two men are, there are a number of ideas or suggestions. Some think that it may be Elijah the prophet, who went up to God in a whirlwind. Remember? Others think it may be Enoch, the man who has never died, in Genesis chapter 5. He was a man who walked with God, and he was not. Why? Because God took him. He started walking with God, and seemingly Enoch said, God, I'm going to go home. I want to go home with you. I don't want to go back to my house. And God took Enoch, and he went on up to heaven, and he has never really died. Others would give some suggestion as to who these two men are, found in the book of Revelation chapter 11. I invite you to read the word of God for yourself. And as I said to my class in FBFA, God expects every generation to know the scriptures. He expected Carrie Ayton to know the scriptures and Willie Ayton to know the scripture. He expects Otha Lee to know the scriptures. He expects you not to just depend on what your pastor said, because there are a lot of false teachers in the world today. And I've got my outline that I'm going to share with you at some point, hopefully the first Sunday night. Listen, we have to get out of this idea that we don't have time to come for worship. We don't have time to study the word. We don't have time to learn. Let us dismiss that idea. God says that men ought to know his word. And that's what Jesus said, you know, when the evil tempted him, evil one tempted Jesus, what did he say? He said, man should not live by bread alone, but by how many? Every single word, whether it's a noun, a verb, an adjective, a participle, or whatever it is, every single word that God has given to us, he holds us responsible for understanding that word. Amen? And I'm just here to encourage you to be encouraged as you read the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. God wants us to know who he is. So, this little book found in Revelation chapter 11 is an important part of the message that God wants to give to us. You see, these books were made of scrolls. They made scrolls out of them. We didn't have books the way we have them today, right? Books were rolled up. A sermon I preached a long time ago, and I left my manuscript up here. But these scrolls, rolled up, the word of God, and God says, I want you to know what I say. This is how we originally got the word of God. They were written on papyrus leaves in Egypt, and God miraculously preserved them so that the hot climate in Egypt preserved them. And in 1947, remember this little boy who threw a stone in the cave? In the cave and heard something crack. And being surprised, he went into the cave and found what is known today as the Dead Sea Scrolls. And scholars took those scrolls and shot chemicals on there and unrolled those scrolls, and they have read them and they have published the Word of God, which was put there right around the time of 200 BC. God preserved his word on scrolls, and those scrolls now have been written, and most people know exactly what's there. This little book that God wrote in to give us guidelines and direction for life, how we can live for him and glorify him and please him, is all in the book, in the word of God. Look at what Revelation 11 tells us here. Here he says, in this passage, Revelation 1, Then I was given a reed, a measuring stick about 20 inches long, a reed like a measuring rod, and the angel stood saying, rise and measure the temple of God, the altar, and those who worship there. Now this is in the tribulation period. It's not happening right now. But God takes notice of whatever goes on in his house. this thing called the temple of God. It is a word which reflects what we have now become. And in the Old Testament, this word temple referred to the place where God dwelt in the perhaps form of, and I don't want to become sacrilegious here, but God was most definitely represented in the Ark of the Covenant. That Ark of the Covenant had angelic beings, cherubims, on the ark, looking down upon the mercy seat. Why? Because on the Day of Atonement, when the priest went into the temple, he took the blood of a lamb, and that blood of a lamb that was a special lamb was sprinkled upon the mercy seat. And when God saw the blood on the mercy seat, he announced to the nation of Israel, "I'll pass over you for one more year." By God's infinite grace, what goes on in the temple is kind of pushed down to us, although the church never replaces Israel. The church is a unique group of people. Those of you who are involved in the local church, God says to them, as we looked at here this morning in a class for youth and men and any other member of this church who is not coming to Sunday school. All right? Yeah, any other member who does not come to Sunday school, that class over there, taught by Pastor Aiden, will be available to you. And when my brother comes in and is giving us help, I defer to Omari, the youth leader of this church. And I thank God for you, brother. And Reverend Love preached a fiery sermon last week. I heard about it. It's a good sermon. Amen. Yeah, he ran it by me before he didn't have to run it by me. But he ran it by me talking about who is Jesus. And if you don't know who Jesus is, well, I'm happy to believe that they're going to be a part of the ministry of Southern Heights Baptist Church, because I have so many big plans for this church. If you're discouraged and despondent and thinking about throwing in the towel, I'm telling you, I'm glad you're here this morning, because I am not discouraged at all. Amen. I thank God for that Bible Institute that we are working on. I've got some training coming to Fort Wayne, hopefully to help train all of the pastors in this local community for the preaching and teaching of the Word of God. And some of us who may have some assets, I'm saying invest what you have in the kingdom work of Jesus Christ. Don't wait around until you die. Invest what you have for the glory and honor of the Lord Jesus. Now, I'm not here this morning to discuss all of the things that I am excited about, but I want to see this church making an impact on this local community for the glory and honor of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what happens in the house of God is important. Now, this word which talks about that is used here, naos. But we are the naos of God. And what did naos refer to in the Old Testament? Well, it referred to the place where only once a year the high priest went into that temple, not the outer court, but into this place where only a man could go once a year, and he had to take the blood of the covenant with him when he went in there and sprinkled it upon the mercy seat, basically saying, "Lord, be merciful to us sinners, because we have no way to get into your presence apart from the sacrificial death, the burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ." So when he says, "Measure the temple," I want to know who is there. I want to know what really is happening in the worship. This word comes into the New Testament, 1 Corinthians 3:16, which says, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And when I gather for worship, and when you gather for worship, we now become the dwelling place in which God, by His Holy Spirit, works and lives in and among us. Just because you're in church, you don't have to necessarily be quiet, but God believes in unity. There's never disunity in God's house. Amen? If the Holy Spirit of God is indwelling us, then whatever happens in the house of the Lord Jesus Christ must reflect the unity of the Godhead found in Ephesians chapter 4. One Lord, one baptism, one faith, one. Because we don't worship three gods. We worship who? One God. Hear, O Israel, we are told in Deuteronomy 6:4. I want you to know this. The Lord our God, the Lord, He is what? He is one. But the one that is used there allows for as the one on your finger. Three joints. And they are independent of each other, but they are dependent upon one another. They are co-equal in every possible way. Now that's a little bit of theology there that sometimes we overlook. Not what T.D. Jakes talks about. He said, why would you call that man's name? This is not a modal thing where he was the father in the Old Testament and then he wrapped himself up and rolled himself into Jesus Christ in the New Testament. And when the New Testament was gone, he wrapped himself up, the Father and the Son, and became the Holy Spirit. God doesn't operate that way. Israel is one. And you say, anytime there is a false teacher, anytime you read the Bible, God exposes false teachers. Really? For what will a false teacher do for you? Same thing that Jim Jones did for the 900 people who drank the poison. You want to follow a false teacher? You better get your head into the Word of God, into the Bible, and see what God says about people whom He has approved. And every time false teachers are mentioned in the Bible, God Himself mentions them. You know the names of those men who withstood Moses? According to 1 Timothy, I believe it's chapter 1. God named them. How did they withstand Moses? Well, when Moses did one thing, they tried their best to duplicate it. How would we ever know who those men were unless we read the Bible? And God says, this is the guy who brought that opposition against the children of Israel, and the 10 plagues in Egypt were led by these false teachers. Hello? Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 4, Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. And he says, the Lord reward him for what he did. Paul had no envy against Alexander the coppersmith. You leave those people alone, whatever they do. May the Lord have mercy upon those who oppose Onesiphorus. And so that's an active subject. And yet, in today's society, the church has resigned itself to Sunday night television, where all kind of false teachers come into their living room, and it has affected the church in today's world. So my point here is this. Make sure you know who you are listening to. The commercial used to be, parents, do you know where your child is? Christian, do you know what you're reading? Do you know what you're studying? But look at, if you will, the court and the temple, and it talks about, but leave it out, the court of the Gentiles, for the reason why I want you to leave it out, for this is a time in which we are told in verse 2, and they will tread the holy city underfoot for 42 months, equaling 3.5 years of this kind of satanic opposition coming against the servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he goes on down in verse 3, and I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy, what? 1,260 days clothed in sackcloth. What's 1,260 days? 3.5 years. Read about it in the book of Daniel, chapter 9, 24. And so what God is saying here is that he's going to protect those who believe in him. He has special powers to do just that. And I want you to notice some of the information that I gave you. I didn't expect to go over all of this in the sermon this morning, but I just want to whet your appetite to what is coming down the pike here. For we're told here that time delayed